Well, good evening. Good evening. Can you hear me all right? No? Yes? No. All right, how's that? Is that better? Am I not close enough? All right, let me try that. Okay. Oh, how's that? Better? Wow. Welcome. Thank you all for attending tonight's lecture. I'm so glad to see so many folks here. Before I get into all of these things I have to say, I'm very curious to hear how you learned about this. So if you got a postcard from the First Division Museum, would you mind raising your hand? Thank you. If you got an email from Cantini Park, would you raise your hand? Wonderful. And if you saw this in the newspaper, oh, it's pretty evenly divided. I'm so thrilled. I hope some of you are new to Cantini and get a little bit of an introduction to us through this lecture series. I'm Diane Gutenkauf. I'm the director of the Robert McCormick Museum, and I'm really so pleased that you've joined us for this program co-presented by the McCormick Museum and the First Division Museum. I've been looking forward to this for roughly 4 years, and I'm frankly a little surprised that it's actually happening. In the course of some general research that McCormick Museum staff were conducting, we came across an article in the Chicago Tribune. On February 11th, 1915, the story read, "Robert R. McCormick of the Tribune sailed yesterday from New York en route to the European war zone. He was accompanied by Donald C. Thompson and Edwin F. Weigel, the Tribune's two famous war photographers." And then the article ended with a teaser. It said, "They will come back with the greatest collection of war films the world perhaps ever will know." So, of course, we knew that Robert McCormick had traveled to Russia in 1915 as the Tribune's war correspondent. He wrote a book about the experience called "With the Russian Army, Being the Experiences of a National Guardsman." The McCormick Research Center's archives hold a lot of information about that trip. But we were really interested in those films. We knew that the film made in Russia was called "With the Russians at the Front." We knew that it debuted at Chicago's Studebaker Theater in August of 1915. And we knew that Robert McCormick personally narrated that first public showing. We even knew that the original film was 3 reels long, but we didn't own a copy and we'd never seen it. So what happened to those films? Could we find them? And could we find them in time to produce a program commemorating the 100th anniversary of their public debut? Well, I probably could take the entire hour just talking about how we tracked down the footage that you're going to see tonight. The short version is that I stumbled on a 1982 article in the journal Kansas History titled "Donald Thompson, Photographer at War." And a footnote in that article noted that the Museum of Modern Art in New York owned a print of the film. Well, lots of emails later, between the Museum of Modern Art and the McCormick Museum, we got them to agree to make a digital copy of the existing 2 reels. We also discovered that the McCormick Research Center archives held what appear to be Colonel McCormick's notes from his public lecture and descriptions of the film scenes. So joining us tonight will be Cantini employee John Hartness portraying Robert McCormick, and he will relay what contemporary film critic Kitty Kelly called the living record of the war stories of the Chicago Tribune. We're also most honored that David Mould, who was the author of that 1982 Kansas History article, agreed to present tonight's lecture. David Mould, PhD, is Professor Emeritus of Media Arts and Studies at Ohio University. He's the author of American News Film, 1914 to 1919, The Underexposed War, and he's written many articles and conference papers on news and documentary film in World War I. Born in the United Kingdom, he began his career as a newspaper and television journalist before he moved to the United States for graduate study in mass media. His PhD is in American Studies, History, Literature, and Cultural Geography. He teaches courses in media history and historiography, international media, communication for human development, and media and politics. Since the mid-1990s, he's worked as a media trainer and consultant, mostly in Central and Southeast Asia, and currently directs a global training course for UNICEF. His recent research on post-Soviet media and his latest book, Postcards from Stanland, Why We Should Care About Central Asia, will be published in the fall of 2015. So now I hope you'll join me in welcoming Dr. David Mould.
I think Diane took almost the whole hour with my bio there. Let's thank Diane. I mean, I think she's a true history detective there. Not only did she locate the film, she also located me. Actually, I'm pretty easy to find on Google. Okay. All right, well, great to see so many people out tonight, and we'll try to make sure that your time is well spent. Okay. If you were a newspaper tycoon like McCormick was in the early part of the 20th century, and you were looking to expand your business and your audience and probably your own public influence, it would have been hard to ignore the fastest growing medium in the early 20th century, the motion picture. The industry had grown by leaps and bounds, not only in Hollywood, but regional production centers. And there were the grand picture palaces here in Chicago, New York, other cities, and small town theaters. If you could afford it by 1914, when World War I began, you were going to the movies at least twice a week. I want to start by putting with the Russians at the front in some context here. And in some ways, we need to think about it as a kind of a long newsreel. Anybody here in the audience remember newsreels, been to newsreels? Yeah, there we go. Okay, remember the newsreels. You talk to young people and they give you blank looks about them. Now, the newsreel dates from the early part of the century. Pathé Frères in France, accredited with doing the first newsreel in 1909, expands to England, 1911, comes to the United States. Competition from other companies, other French companies, Gaumont, and maybe most formidably of all, William Randolph Hearst, another media tycoon there. And throughout World War I, all of these companies were in competition to get their newsreels into theaters. There's a quote from Hearst there about having the greatest news-gathering organization in the world and the biggest and livest camera staff, whatever that means, okay? Okay, it's a little difficult. I have to turn around and make sure the PowerPoint's changing here. I'm sure the technology works well. Most big city newspapers also launch newsreels, even though they might have a regional distribution. So, you know, McCormick's media empire was smaller than Hearst's, but by 1914, the Chicago Tribune Animated Weekly was being seen in small and large theaters throughout the states. Now, you know, this was probably not a profitable venture. Okay, as some startups are. But think about it in other terms, in terms of extending the brand of the Tribune, the world's greatest newspaper, and, you know, building audience, I think it's important. And so until commercial radio comes along in the 1920s and we get WGN, movies offered the best opportunity for newspaper owners to build a media empire. A lot of people have dismissed the newsreels and the longer films, like with the Russians at the front, as kind of inconsequential. But There's no evidence that contemporary audiences looked at them that way. And I guess that's one of the things I want to say to you tonight. You know, it's difficult, but we have to kind of put ourselves in the position of contemporary audiences. Imagine it's 1915 and you don't have all of the sophisticated media experiences that you have now. It's difficult to put yourself back into that mindset. And these films are important because before the advent of network television news, they are, in fact, a national visual medium, a kind of a shared mediated experience for all Americans. Now, it doesn't happen at the same time because people go to the movies at different times, but week after week, people are seeing the same images, both of domestic affairs and international affairs. So I don't want to get too much into media theory here, but the newsreels, well, although they were sometimes inconsequential, did set an agenda about what people thought was important, the people that they recognized. I mean, people like Theodore Roosevelt really, you know, projected his image through the newsreels. So pictures were a universal language. We're also looking at a time in American history where there are many first-generation immigrants and, you know, they're not able to read the newspaper or not read it very well. So the visual image, and especially the moving visual image, becomes really, really important. And in fact, the newsreels lasted till the 1950s in the United States, longer in other countries. I remember in the 1960s in Britain still going to newsreel theatres. Today we use terms such as converged journalism, multimedia journalist. These are modern inventions, but we have to remember in the early part of the century, it was kind of going on, although the terms were not used. If you were a news photographer, you probably shot both still pictures and motion pictures, and the photographer we'll feature tonight, Donald Thompson, certainly did both. And you were shooting for newspapers, illustrated magazines, and longer compilation films. And there's also, you know, especially in McCormick's case, a very aggressive cross-promotional strategy going on. So the Tribune runs full-page display ads promoting its films, articles about the colonel's exploits in the war zone, and, you know, the movie coverage enhances the credibility of the news organization. So McCormick, like others, was fairly prescient in kind of using another medium, even though it was not going to necessarily be profitable in terms of, you know, in terms of income, to really enhance the credibility of the news organization. So, World War I. A big news opportunity, and every editor in the United States was going, how are we going to get the news from Europe? So Patterson, the editor of the Tribune, he is fairly enterprising. He gets permission from the Belgian government for a photographer, Edwin Weigel, to film at the siege of Antwerp. And there's a kind of a controversy over, you know, the Tribune's, you know, what, you know, whether the Tribune spoke of Belgian atrocities, sorry, German atrocities in Belgium, which is another issue aside. But, you know, again, the Tribune's being fairly enterprising here in getting a photographer in. Remember that at this time there are no press pools, no photographic pools. Armies don't know what to do with journalists and photographers. They're likely to regard them as spies and sometimes shoot them. So it's a dangerous thing. So you kind of have to go through the authorities to try to secure permission, although that represents some compromises by itself. In a city like Chicago, with a large immigrant population, it's important to, at least in the early years of the war, to appear neutral. But think about the difficulties of war coverage if you're a photographer, or indeed a reporter, a journalist, approaching the war, you're only really going to be able to cover it from one side. You can't go hopping over the trenches. Yeah, well, today I think I'll go report on the German side. Oh, we'll come back and see the French. No, you know, you're pretty much stuck on one side of the lines, and so inevitably your perspective on the conflict is going to be coloured that way. And that's what I think we see in pretty much all of the war coverage during World War One. So in August 1915, pretty interesting month, the Tribune actually puts out two films. McCormick is showing with the Russians at the front, shot by Donald Thompson, who's the guy on the right there. And the photo, actually, from my collection, is fairly timely because it's dated February the 20th, which is just a few days after he and McCormick sail for Europe. And then about a week later, we get the German side of the war from Weigel, and I'll explain in a bit kind of how the two photographers went their different ways. But it's quite interesting that within a week you get a film that unabashedly shows the Russian side of the war from the Russian perspective and is very complimentary of the Russians, the Russian army, and you know, a week later the Tribune is showing the German side of the war, and you'll see the quote there which says, you know, it's Germany has a great military machine. So which do you believe? Well, I guess at least the Tribune's presenting both sides of the story. So our story tonight really begins a little earlier, the fall of 1914. McCormick is embroiled in the business affairs of the newspaper, advertising, circulation, newsprint supply, all of that stuff. And as he writes in his book, with the Russian army, he's really not thinking too much about events overseas. But there are connections here. His father, Robert Sanderson McCormick, had served as U.S. ambassador to Russia, 1902 to 1905. His mother, Catherine Medill McCormick, kept up her connections with Russian diplomats, including the ambassador to the U.F., George Makhmitev. And so in October 2014, McCormick sent a telegram to his mother in Washington. I'm not going to read it. You can read it there, okay? So several telegrams going back and forth between McCormick and his mother, asking her to intercede with the Russian ambassador to get him permission to accompany the Russian army. McCormick then writes a letter to the ambassador, Makhmitev, and there's more correspondence than this. And, I mean, this is pretty interesting because, I mean, it's fairly clear here that he is making the case that if he's allowed to go with the Russian army, he's going to prevent a positive image of them to Americans. There's a longer correspondence in which McCormick says that, you know, Russia was fairly well regarded in the United States until the Russo-Japanese War, and then the Japanese turned opinion against the Russians. So, you know, he's kind of trying to make a little bit of a deal here, promising positive coverage for access. The Russians, like the French and the British, weren't very keen to let correspondents visit their army. But Makhmitev, swayed either by the power of the press, what McCormick was promising, or maybe just as much by the kind of the family connections, agreed. So here's the timeline. I'm sorry, I'm 3 days off. Should be February the 10th, 2015. McCormick, accompanied by Donald Thompson and the other photographer, Weigel, they sail, as the Tribune put it later, warward. I thought that was kind of a nice little phrase. They get to England. There's a German submarine blockade, so the lights on the ship have to be put out so they can get into harbour. McCormick sort of does the usual round of meetings with the Prime Minister, Asquith, the Foreign Secretary, other British officials. He talks to Winston Churchill and has those kind of sort of policy-level discussions. So, you know, he's kind of portraying himself as, you know, something of a representative of American public opinion, which I think he probably had some idea about. They go across the channel to France, more meetings with French officials there, and McCormick does go to the front, the Western Front near Arras. The French want him to see the destruction of churches and historical buildings. The group then splits up. Weigel goes on to Germany, where he shoots the footage that eventually becomes the German side of the war. McCormick and Thompson travel via the Balkans to Petrograd, today St. Petersburg, arriving in April 1915. There's a short audience with Tsar Nicholas II, which, you know, is kind of briefly described in the book. It doesn't seem like there was much of a conversation there. McCormick wrote, he mostly writes about all the pomp and circumstance, the liveried footman, the furniture, the paintings of Louis XIV and stuff like that, like Marco Polo at the court of the Chinese emperor. Then he moves on to Warsaw, which is going to be his base for coverage, and Thompson catches up with him there. So, we now need to imagine, if we can, that we're in the packed audience at the Studebaker Theatre on Michigan Avenue, near Van Buren, on the evening of August the 22nd for the premiere of With the Russians at the Front. And for the past month, the Tribune's been heavily promoting this premiere. It's included some excerpts from the film in the newsreel, the Chicago Tribune Animated Weekly. And see some of the quotes there. Exclusive permission, you know, approach within a few feet of the Tsar of Russia. You know, so there's some pretty heavy promotional stuff going on here. And, you know, a lot is promised here, and I want to tell you right now, please don't expect the greatest war pictures ever shown. You know, you're not going to see those. You're going to see fairly typical World War I stuff. So let's just look at what's actually happening in the war there, because there's some difference between what's happening in the war and the way in which McCormick presents it. So this is just a map of the Eastern Front, and it shows, the darker line is the limits of the Russian advance into Poland, and then the Russians were, at least in the north, pretty substantially beaten back. So there's a series of actions here that take place. The Russians lose a lot of prisoners at the Battle of Tannenberg. The war sort of fought on two fronts, in the north in Poland and down in the Carpathian Mountains in Galicia, where there's a siege of a fortress, and I'm going to try to pronounce the Polish name here, Przemyśl, which lasts for a long time. It's a fairly famous siege. And that changes hands. But anyway, you know, by the time that McCormick is heading back to the US in the summer of 1915, the Russians are in a strategic retreat. Okay, they're never going to, you know, make as much progress again. There'll be a few advances and setbacks, but they're pretty much getting pushed back to a defensive line there. What happened? Well, all sorts of issues. McCormick talks a lot about the lack of railways to provide communications for troops and supplies, but historians also recognize that the Russian commanders were fairly incompetent, and there was really a lack of supplies getting to the front. There is a contrast here. By the time the film is shown, the Russian army is in general retreat, but if you are to read Thompson's book and look at the film, you would think Russia had a mighty military machine. Okay, a few words about the film itself. As Diana said, it is incomplete. We've got about 23 minutes of the original three-reel feature. And one of the things notable is that McCormick mentions in his notes some scenes which are missing from the version that we have. And there are others that are in different order. And there are some scenes in the film that he doesn't mention. So it's a bit of a jigsaw puzzle to try to put this together. As somebody wisely said once, film has no footnotes. So putting things together, figuring out where something comes from, is really quite a puzzle. And I've worked with quite a few films from this period where, which have been cut up and spliced back together and bits from here and bits from there. I think we can be pretty confident that everything in this film is from the original with the Russians up the front, but it's in a different order. And for the sake of narrative continuity, I've edited a little bit to restore some order. This is where I lower the expectations. We have sophisticated media experiences. It's a little difficult to remember all that promotion for the film to kind of grasp how audiences at that time would have viewed it. But let's remember, the motion picture is still a young medium. When Louis Lumiere shot a film of a train coming towards the camera, people ran out of the cinema because they thought they were going to be mowed down by the train. When a fictional film showing the Kaiser was put on the screen, a man stood up in Dubuque, Iowa, and fired a pistol at the screen. We're going to sort of settle the war now. We're going to kill the Kaiser. So people accept, there's this illusion of reality with it. And let's think about the kind of war that it was. World War I was a very technological war. Most of the people who died in it never saw the people who killed them. They were killed long distance by mines, by artillery. So access to the front is difficult, and one of the issues here is that the conditions for fighting and the conditions for filming are exactly opposite. When the sun is bright in the sky and the light is good, and it's good for filming, nobody's doing any fighting. Everybody's down, hunkered down. When it's cold and dark and misty, and you can't get any images, that's when the fighting goes on in general there. So there's a sort of contradiction between conditions for fighting and conditions for filming. And I think the quote from McCormick backs that up there. So let me congratulate you on getting your 25-cent ticket to tonight's premiere. You're the lucky ones. There's still a line stretching down to Van Buren. The only thing we're missing is the orchestra here. Now, I talked to Diane about this. I sort of thought we'd maybe bring the Chicago Symphony in, provide the music. But she said something about budgets. I didn't quite understand what she was saying. The point here is that, we talk about silent film, but that's always a misnomer, because all films before the advent of film sound was shown with some musical accompaniment, and in this case, it would have been probably a small theater orchestra, and they would have had probably some Russian music there. So you're going to have to put up with a few pauses tonight. You can hum along appropriately if you like. The film was accompanied by a lecture from McCormick. As I say, we don't have a transcript. We have his notes from the archives. And what I've done here is I've combined these with some comments that he made in the book with the Russian army, where he describes some of the same scenes. Okay, playing the role of Colonel McCormick tonight, but he's not wearing the Illinois National Guard uniform I was expecting him to wear. We have museum staff member John Hartness. Come on up, John. And what I need to do is I need to sit down at a chair there and give a few cues to John as the film goes, okay?
Shrimp Thompson is the young Topeka corn-fed product who has written K-A-N-S-A-S across the war map of Europe. He was in 32 battles in Belgium. I consider Grand Duke Nicholas Nikolaevich Romanov, cousin of the present Tsar, the greatest soldier that the war produced. All summer and fall, the Kaiser's objective was to crush France and the Grand Dukes to pull back the attack until time and a plethora of factories could permit France and England to supply serious military deficiencies, which the war discovered. The Grand Duke introduced me to mon frère, the Grand Duke Peter. History will not do justice to this charming man. Who will say he has not played an important part in the work supporting his great brother in his trials? The Grand Duke in his 59th year, in appearance, he is 10 years younger, due, I suppose, to his fondness for out-of-door exercise. The Grand Duke talked about the war, about the difficulty from the lack of railroads, of the advantages which came from the simple style of living of the Russians. The Russian army has a staff principle developed in great detail. I could perceive also that information was interchanged. It is just this extraordinary ability to maneuver in action that has offset the Germans' superiority in railway facilities. Mountain warfare is the only warfare these days where anything can be seen. Before us on a mountain whose almost perpendicular top made it impregnable to bayonet assault, lay the most advanced Austrian position. But this very position, so secure against infantry, was a particularly good mark for artillery. A battery of artillery is seen in action in the Carpathians. The cannon are so carefully concealed from the enemy as to be nearly invisible to the camera. Modern artillery fire is so accurate that once the location of a gun is known to the enemy, its destruction is inevitable. On the Eastern Front, woods are so common as to furnish all the cover necessary. In northern France and Belgium, however, guns sometimes must be sunk in the fields and covered with earth and grass, elaborately prepared to simulate the natural ground. The Russian field artillery is extraordinarily good. I speak with knowledge because I have frequently seen it in action. At the outbreak of war, it was said to be composed of 6,000 pieces, divided into batteries of 8 guns. These guns were, in general, 3-inch field pieces modeled after the famous French 75s, 4.5-inch 6-inch field howitzers, and the great Russian 6-inch field artillery gun. For the benefit of the uninitiated, I will explain that howitzers and the heavy field artillery, firing at different ranges, use different charges of explosive. It is probably known to everybody at this time that guns are seldom sighted at the enemy. A horizontal line is established by a spirit level, and the range being approximately ascertained, the gun is elevated a given number of degrees. The commander of the battery establishes himself in some point of advantage and by telephone instructs his gunners. Automatic rangefinders are sometimes used for the first shot, and I have seen a baseline established and the range found by trigonometry, but after the first shot, the range is corrected by the sight of the exploding shells. Another novelty not before shown in moving pictures is field artillery mounted on specially prepared gun pits. These guns were taken at the headquarters of the 2nd Army commanded by General Smirnov, a peasant of the lowest rank who by his great military ability has risen to be one of the leading generals under the Tsar. The general held a practice drill of the air battery, and to make the spectacle more realistic, sent up a repair German aeroplane shot down by this same battery a while before. Around sailed the airship, around the Russian gunners swung their guns, giving evidence of the tremendous physical strength, which is a distinctive feature of this army. I stood with one of the range-finding officers and was impressed with the superiority of this contrivance over the automatic rangefinder used in France. Before, the Austrian trenches were intricate wire entanglements. In comparison to them, the Russian entanglements appeared flimsy, not built to keep the enemy out, but let our own men through. I had heard in the hotel lobbies of Petrograd a lot of rumors of a shocking lack of hospital facilities and attendance. Mr. Guchoff, a former chairman of the Duma, and his wife showed us the field hospitals, splendid examples of medical efficiency. The division hospital was now intense. Polish boys acted as orderlies, and women, true to their heaven-sent mission, were patiently suffering in mind for the wounded in body. The patient in this tent is an Austrian prisoner suffering from a shrapnel wound. I went to Russia with the popular conception of the Cossacks, namely that they were a nomad tribe from Central Asia, that they dressed in skins, that when they went to war, they took their women with them. In a word, that they were in approximately the same state of civilization as the Mexicans. But on my first trip to the front, I was given an exhibition drill by two satnya, or as we would call it, two troops of Cossacks. and as I was at the time unfamiliar with the details of the Russian uniform, I could not distinguish between the Cossacks and the other soldiers. The Cossack considers himself a soldier always, and not merely during his term of service. Every Cossack soldier provides his own uniform and horse, of which he naturally takes the best care, and which he has trained beyond anything within my experience. After my return from Russia, I was astounded to hear from a European military officer that the Cossacks were an irregular body of guerrillas, useful to harry a defeated enemy army, but unable to contend with regular troops. The truth is that they are to regular troops what regular troops are to the militia. The Cossacks are frontiersmen. We know the superiority of frontiersmen over all other troops of equal training. In addition to this, the Cossacks are a hereditary military organization like the samurai of Japan. Where other European troops are trained for 3 years, these are trained from childhood. The result is that the Cossacks are a body of soldiers such as exists nowhere else in the world. I speak with confidence, for I have been to see all the Allies' armies. I have been a horseman for 25 years, and I have played polo constantly in the last 12. There is no considerable body of troops in the world that can, mounted, offer any serious resistance to the Cossacks. Military exercises seem to me foolish formalities before I came to war. They do look foolish at home, but in sound of the enemy's guns, even the strut step has its value. The straightened back and the lifted head react favorably upon the nervous system of the man about to go under fire. The eager response to orders is to a regiment what the snap is to a football team. A regiment that has learned its drill feels a thrill of conscious strength as it wheels into line and is built up to resist the terrors which the individual courage could not withstand. On the march, the Russian soldier is fed from the field kitchen, a huge cauldron in which the national soup or stew is cooked. This is composed of a ration of meat and grain and potatoes for each man with what other vegetables the cook can lay his hands on. My investigation impressed me with the great advantage of an organized nation at war over a nation defended by a professional army. To the fact that Russia is a nation at war, not a nation with only its army at war, may be attributed the extraordinary completeness of its organization back of the firing line. A vast traffic of ammunition, of supplies, of soldiers and horses arriving to fill the losses, of slightly wounded going to the rear on foot or in empty transport wagons. Russia has developed a system of transport easy for her to produce, which can travel on any kind of roads and can be supplied indefinitely. She has for the frontline work small 2- and 4-wheel wagons. The following scenes are taken in the lines north of the Rolka River, from which the Russians have recently retreated. The soldiers are men of the Simonovsky Regiment of the Imperial Guard, one of the crack regiments of the Empire. The photographer would visit this regiment during an interval between combats. The men were delighted at the diversion afforded them and threw themselves into the making of pictures with enthusiasm. These pictures were not taken under fire, but are the exact reproductions of the method of the Russian infantry in attack carried out by the men who have been fighting in the war from its beginning. The scene at the top of the wall is also staged by the enthusiastic soldiers, but the wall is the actual front line of the Russian defense, and the troops are the troops appointed to defend that particular position. The wall is, of course, exceedingly strong against infantry attack, but absolutely indefensible against heavy artillery, which would knock it to pieces in short order and make every brick a weapon to destroy the defenders.
Sorry, I'll get you. All right, take care.
Okay, so probably not the greatest war pictures you've ever seen. But these are very typical of what audiences would be seeing during this period. And, I mean, I've deliberately not shortened some of these shots here. So that, you know, we could replicate the experience. I mean, half of me wants to speed this up, you know, but that would be historically inaccurate to do. This is what audiences saw. And again, remember the music's going in the background and the rousing marches and the horn sections coming in, and, you know, the audience would have rehearsed it along with that. So, with the Russians at the front. So I want to make one note on language here, or at least a term. McCormick's referring there to the Kazakhs and their prowess as cavalry. He was, in fact, talking about not the Kazakhs as we know them today, but the Cossacks. And although the Cossacks are also renowned for their horsemanship. And just an explanation for this. By the mid-19th century, Russian armies had conquered most of Siberia and Central Asia. And the Russians, in order to, you know, distinguish the ethnic groups out there, you know, the Russians started calling the Cossacks, who lived in like southern Siberia, Kazakhs. Now that was then a problem when they got to the Kazakhs themselves. You know, what were they going to call them? Well, they called them Kyrgyz, okay? And then that was another problem when they got to the Kyrgyz. What were they going to call them? They called them Kara Kyrgyz, which actually means black Kyrgyz. So it was not until the 1930s, the Stalin era, the one thing we have Stalin to thank for, that the ethnic groups actually got their proper names back, you know, because the Russians are confused things. But, I mean, that's why McCormick can't tell the difference between the Kazakhs, who he thinks are Central Asian, and the Russian army, because, you know, they're Russians, you know, they ethnically they look the same. So just a little note there. Okay, this is where I do the academic thing, and you know, these are the five things you need to take away from this presentation. Okay, let's talk first about narrative structure. War is chaotic, okay? And films such as With the Russians tend to impose a narrative structure on it, you know, linking events across time and space. and the titles provide some context, and they also are telling you how you should interpret the image. Let's recognize that at this time we don't have, you know, we don't have competing media sources. You can't go to another film to check it. This is the only film. This is the only film about the Russian army. Okay, there are no other films available. And there's a dramatic structure to these films as well. So the titles and the music provide a sense of sequence and cohesion, joining together these little fragments of reality. And that really is what we have here, just a series, really, of fragments or scenes into a kind of reconstructed reality. McCormick plays several roles here, somewhat conflicting. He's certainly the Tribune correspondent, reporting on what he's seen and heard, but you know he uses his position in the Illinois National Guard to help gain access, and he also presents himself as a military expert. He's providing expert analysis of artillery range finding, the designs of fortifications, the strategy of the Russian general staff. And also, he's unashamedly pro-Russian in his attitudes. So, you know, from a kind of a journalistic perspective, he's really kind of crossing the line between observer and participant. His photographer, Donald Thompson, whose career I've studied, and that's kind of how I got into this story, probably went even further. He sort of described himself as a photographer adventurer. And, people like Thompson kind of reveled in the attention that war offered. I've been doing a little work in the archives since I was here and discovering a little bit about McCormick's rather tortured relationship with Thompson, who I think he considered to be a drunk and a rogue. And as far as I can tell, you know, Thompson ran up bills at hotels and stores all over Europe and then disappeared, also taking the Tribune's motion picture equipment with him. And McCormick into 1916 was sort of paying bills and settling lawsuits on his behalf. So, in Thompson's later career, I looked into the 1920s when he was arrested for posing as a naval lieutenant and passing bad checks. But, you know, he was a man of his time, an adventurer. He lived high, you know, he made money, you know, he spent it freely, he, you know, married four times. So, you know, very much a person of the age there. Challenges of working in the war zone. We've talked a little bit about this. Real physical and practical difficulties. The military doesn't want you there. They don't know what to do with you. You know, journalists, correspondents, photographers are new. There is censorship. There have been cases where censors have taken film out of a camera and held it up to see what's on there. You know what that does to film before it's been developed. Not a good idea. You're also dependent on the military force for transportation, food, and facilities. So, you know, inevitably you're going to show one side of the conflict. I should have tried to include a picture of a motion picture camera of the time, but this is a big, bulky thing, you know? I mean, it's as tall as the camera there, but, you know, large. You know, it's an unfamiliar item of technology. People have not seen movie cameras before. You take that thing and you put it over the top of a trench, and somebody in the opposite trench looks at it and go, well, it's a gun. Let's shoot it. So, you know, there are many cases where, you know, cameras have been shot away because they've been mistaken for some newfangled form of weaponry. But interesting enough, the war also spurs some technological innovation. So the gyroscopic stabilizer on the tripod is something that developed in World War I. The real challenge is audience expectations. Since the war started, Hollywood's been churning out stuff like this, you know, cheap war dramas. You know, this is just one from 1914, you know. Because of the problems of obtaining footage and the time it took to obtain footage from the war zone and the fact that it was pretty unexciting when it arrived, you know, audiences really preferred the fictional version of war. This was much more reassuring. It was full of desperate cavalry charges and hand-to-hand combat and maidens rescued from, you know, beastly soldiers. You know, I mean, those are the kind of dramas, those are the kind of scripts that work very well. You know, this is an example here. I mean, it implies it's a documentary film, but is actually shot in Burbank. And I love the thing about, you know, a lot of exposing, standing around in exposed positions on the part of the soldiers. By contrast, World War I, pretty dull and drab. The stuff that Thompson, as you've seen, and others obtained, mostly shot behind the lines, not in the front. It's a war of logistics. It's supply columns. It's marching troops and prisoners and parades and drills, but very little actual combat. And even, I mean, I'll diverge a little bit, you know, even some of the most famous over-the-top charges, such as from the British film The Battle of the Somme, have been proved to have been shot, in fact, on practice grounds, not at the front. And as I've said before, the best times for fighting are the worst times for filming, and vice versa. We're right always to be skeptical about mediated images, but it's really interesting how in the early part of the century, people really believed that the camera could not lie, that what happened in front of the camera was true and could not be faked. The only real and incorruptible neutral in the war is not the type, but the film. Moving picture camera, utterly without bias, and records and reports does not distort. However, it's very difficult to get footage at the front. So many of the scenes, you know, most of the stuff with the artillery there, and certainly the final scenes in that film, are set up for the camera. Well, as McCormick says, you know, the soldiers came out and, you know, played movie actors for the day, and enjoyed it. And actually, you know, McCormick's more honest about this than some others, you know, working in that period, because, you know, he says the pictures were not taken under fire, but, you know, it's the same place, and it's how the Russian infantry would be if they were under attack. Now, there's one interesting thing about that final scene, and that's the one where the soldiers run past the camera. Okay, give the soldiers, please run. And then they're firing off the top of the wall. McCormick writes about a city in Poland. This is where there was a long siege, Przemyśl. I'm pronouncing that wrong, I'm sure. And he writes about how there was little physical damage to the city, but there's no footage in the film that we have. However, you know, the Chicago Tribune Animated Weekly has a scene that's described, which shows this. Okay, this is from the description from the Chicago Animated Weekly, and it's from the beleaguered fortress of Przemyśl. You see the men fighting behind the wall, shooting through apertures that they and the enemy's shells have made. You see men who can find no hole climb to the top of the tottering wall. You see the men as they're hit drop from the wall and fall dying or dead to the ground. Reading that looks very much like that last sequence we saw in the film. But what's happened here is that the Chicago Tribune Animated Weekly has moved the action from Lomza, which is where McCormick said it took place, and it probably did, south to Przemyśl, okay, which is the beleaguered fortress, and is presenting it here not as something that was set up, but as something that's happened. something that is a genuine thing. So, there's all of these kind of conundrums about these films, what was set up, what wasn't. In this particular case, it does appear that the Tribune's kind of having it both ways. In this newsreel, it's claiming that this is real fighting going on when we get to with the Russians at the front. No, they did it for the camera. And, McCormick's sort of well aware that staging and faking goes on. He once recalled when he served on the Chicago Sanitary Board at the turn of the century, he granted a permit for a movie about the Boer War along a drainage canal. So, as I say here, questions about that sequence, which I think is probably from Lomzer, and it's definitely set up. Given the difficulties of filming and also the fact that we don't have kind of comparative images, a lot of what went on, a lot of what was presented as footage from the front, the Western Front, the Eastern Front, was absolutely not. Okay? Too expensive, too difficult to maintain, much easier to shoot, at Edison, New Jersey, in the trenches of New Jersey or the trenches of Burbank. We can build it there, we can build a movie set, and things like that. And again, audiences don't have a point of comparison. They don't necessarily identify this. So if the title says, this is on the front in Lemberg or Rocha or somewhere like that, who are we to say anything else? I think this issue is a good question to apply to other conflicts where military forces offer to kind of put on the show for the cameras. I'd like to thank you for coming out tonight. I'd be really happy to take any questions. This has been so much fun for me. I just love this stuff, as you can probably tell. And again, thank you to Diane for inviting me tonight. Thank you. So questions, comments?
If you have questions for our guest speaker tonight, please show us by raising your hands and waiting until you have the microphone before asking your question, please, for the cameras. Thank you.
Oh, she's very strict, isn't she?
Okay, so I'm not sure how close to hold this thing or not, but...
You're doing fine.
Okay, very well. Do we know what happened to the other movie, the German movie?
The German side of the war. No. Does anybody here know? I would love to find it, okay? There's so much that's been lost, okay? More than we can know. Now, what, just a technical point here. Films at this time were shot on what was called nitrate stock, okay? Which is highly inflammable if kept for a certain time. And so... and also deteriorates. So many, many films or parts of films have been lost. I don't rule it out that at some point somebody will dig in the permafrost in Canada and unearth the German side of the war and some other treasures there. But many have been lost, and the only accounts we then have are the newspaper accounts and the motion picture trade press accounts. I would love to see it. Because, as I say, all I've read are some accounts about it, and it would really be fascinating to play these two back to back, wouldn't it?
Next, please. Did I see one over here?
Just a real quick one. How much did McCormick's input or into the American psyche, the visual from the film? How much did that play into us deciding to go to help out our friends in Europe?
It's a little difficult to say here. I wouldn't say that this film, in particular, would. He's presenting a very positive view of the Russians. So in that respect, he's kind of saying to Americans, hey, if you go in, on that side in the war, there's this mighty military machine in the East, which will then enable you to help out the French and the British there. That's one of those difficult historical questions. What I would say, though, is that newspapers like the Tribune and, their ancillary... media enterprises like the newsreels, were very, very powerful. I mean, in the Spanish-American War, the influence of Hearst and others and in decisions to go to war. But, it's one of those difficult things in media, to what extent do media influence people and public policy? It's a tough one. It's really tempting to draw a link, but it's not something scientifically you can. All I would say here is that if you were to go and see with the Russians at the front, you would come away with a much better impression of Russia's situation in the war. I mean, let's remember what happens, 2 years later. It's the Russian Revolution. The whole thing collapses. And one of the things I would like to do is to look at how McCormick viewed that. I mean, there's this great Russian military machine, how could the whole thing fall apart, I suspect that his attitude would be like his photographer Thompson's, that it's all a German plot, The Russian people really love the Tsar, and the Germans have come in and plotted it. But again, I'd have to read a little bit more on that. I mean, your question's an interesting one, but I can't answer it.
Were any of these used as propaganda?
I'm sorry.
Were any of these used as propaganda?
Well, depends what we mean by propaganda, doesn't it? I mean, yeah, it is. It is propaganda. I mean, in a sense, any media message is propaganda in one way or another. Yeah, it's propaganda for the Russians. I mean, McCormick's gone in. He's, with the blessing of Makhmetev, he's made contacts with the general staff. He's met the Tsar. Yeah, I mean, the Russians were pretty pleased about what was happening there, and was definitely endorsing it. Now, do we define that as propaganda? That's probably a broader issue there. But maybe no more or less than the German side of the war or the British propaganda films or the French propaganda films. I mean, Thompson went on to film a lot in France and, portrayed the French as a formidable military machine, again, at the time when they were getting pushed back in 1915 and 1916 and the mutiny in the French army in 1917. So again, all these films in that respect are, propaganda. And I think, it mostly comes out of the fact that, today, it's possible for correspondents to, take a broader perspective and, look at some other images. But, I mean, these photographers and journalists and reporters, they're stuck on one side of the lines. Inevitably, they're going to present that view.
Thank you for presenting, and thanks for coming. My question goes kind of with the first. What happened to, not so much with the film, but did Weigel's work get published in the Tribune? Is there anything? I know you focused on Thompson.
Yeah.
Did he cover anything? Maybe not the film, but are there press reports from his side of the story that got published in the Tribune that you can find?
On Weigel?
Yeah.
I haven't looked, okay? That is something I need to look at. All research is incomplete. Yeah, the people like Weigel and Thompson sort of like flitted around a lot. I think Weigel was probably a more reliable photographer than Thompson, who skedaddled, with the Tribune's motion picture equipment and leaving bad debts all over the place. Weigel sort of disappears from the scene pretty soon. I mean, he's been in Belgium, he's been in Germany, and, I did sort of check the motion picture press. He doesn't pop up again, so I really don't know what happened to Weigel, but I kind of want to follow his story as well and trace him down. So maybe I'll see in a couple of years, I'll be able to tell you what happened to Weigel, okay? Are you related to him? Or no.
All right, I have one in the back over here.
I also want to thank you for your lecture and coming here today. I had two questions for you. First, could you talk about the logistics of Colonel McCormick narrating? Was there a PA system? Was he standing on the stage? That's my first question. And my second question is, could you tell us about the reaction of the public or civic leaders or other media at the time to this film?
He would have stood on stage and projected, okay? you know, this is really, but you know, it's before the age of PA at this point, so he would have just, you know, like a politician, had to project to the back of the hall. And I presume that what happened is that when he was speaking, the orchestra would have quietened down very sort of just a little bit in the background, perhaps. Okay, reaction. The Tribune gave it good reviews. I actually came across a letter today in the archives from a civic leader in Chicago, which says, "Oh, these Russian pictures are wonderful. You know, congratulations." So, and the trade press covered them well. Now, yeah, but you know, again, it's kind of anecdotal. It's piecemeal. It's difficult to know. I mean, I think people were just like, "Wow, stuff from Russia. There's the Tsar, and the Tsar's like here, just in front of my face." You know, I mean, I think that's it. I mean, it's more the wow factor to seeing pictures from a very, very distant place. And let's remember, you know, I mean, it's just, Chicago, not Polish here, and so there would be some connection there. So, but again, it comes back to the kind of the question about, you know, whether this had any influence on anything. You know, those are always really, really difficult questions, and I'm not going to jump too far now. Just as I don't jump into military matters, I should have said to begin with, don't ask me about those guns. I'm a film historian, not a military historian. People know more about them than I do.
Sir, two items. First of all, I do tours, school tours through the museum here. Mm-hmm. And we have a newsreel on Sicily that we show, and
World War II, right? Yeah.
Yeah, and I could second your comment about the kids having no idea what a newsreel is, even though I try to explain it a little bit. Another thing, did you guys do any searching through like the U.S. military film archives for any of this stuff?
Well, this would have been, you know, of course, before the U.S. entered World War One. So, I mean, this is all sort of commercial film. After the U.S. enters World War One, the Signal Corps pretty much sort of takes control of motion pictures, and everybody has to kind of go through the Signal Corps. So, the stuff that the military has. Although a lot of it actually is sort of passed to, the National Archives. Like, there's a lot of stuff in the National Archives from the Signal Corps. So there would have been no particular reason for the military to, you know, get a hold of films like that. But if you have any suggestions on where I should look in terms of military archives, I'd be really happy to talk to you about that.
Well, and if I may, there's one place I haven't looked, and that's Belgium, Germany, and Russia, because my understanding is that some of the films that the Tribune produced were considered the official newsreels of those countries. And since I haven't had the opportunity to get there, it is possible that there are clips that still exist mm-hmm. somewhere in archives in Belgium, Germany, or Russia.
Time to take a trip.
Thank you for an excellent presentation.
Is the mic on?
Thanks for an excellent presentation. One small detail, the gentleman Weigel traveling to Germany from England while mm-hmm. the war was on, was that perhaps through?
He would have probably gone through Holland, Netherlands. He would have probably traveled to the Netherlands, a neutral country, and then into Germany from there.
I guess I think Netherlands was neutral.
Yeah. So that would have been the usual way. I mean, in the early part of the war, actually in Belgium, you know, people like Weigel were actually shuffling between both both sides of the lines because things were not that sad. But, you know, at that point, once the Western Front got pretty much demarcated and things were not moving much, then you would have to go through the Netherlands or Sweden or somewhere like that, you know, maybe to Sweden, you know, to get in there. You'd have to go through a neutral country to get in, unless you could talk or bribe your way through, which they sometimes tried to do, yeah.
Is there one more question?
One other.
You mentioned that there was a missing portion of the film. Do mm-hmm. we know anything about the content of that missing portion?
Well, all we know are the notes that we have from McCormick. So there's a two or three scenes there. One's about supply wagons. One's about some, some exchange on the front line. So we have his notes on that. So we have a sense of, what those scenes are about. Okay. Whether there's other stuff that's missing, I don't know. As I say, it's a big jigsaw puzzle trying to put this all back together. And unfortunately, I come back to my quote, film has no footnotes. Piecing it all together is a real challenge because what's happened over the years is this film's been cut up and spliced and put into compilations. I've looked at stuff in archives where you're looking at stuff from 1914, 1915, and then suddenly in the middle was something from 1918 that's put in there, because the way that film has been sold is, the stock shot, the people who do the compilations, it's like, okay, can you give me, I need 15 seconds of tanks, okay? I need 15 seconds of marching infantry, I don't care where it's from, just give me the tanks, And so things have kind of got cut up and spliced together there, and putting it back together, is a huge issue. Usually, to some degree, you can tell by the uniforms, but there are some incredible things where, documentaries have been done where, footage has been taken from a completely different place and to represent something else there. So again, a big prize, I'm sure, the museum will present a big prize to anybody who can find the third reel with the Russians at the front. We'd love to have it. I mean, it's, again, one of those things like the German side of the war I'd love to find. There's another one I would love to find. I'm just sort of putting this out there in case anybody thinks about it. Thompson shot a film in Russia in 1917 after the Russian Revolution called The German Curse in Russia, which sort of pretty much represents what he thought of what was going on there. Again, press reports on it, interesting stuff, completely gone as far as I know.
Did he send his work back as he was filming it, or did he wait until he was finished and then brought it all back?
Okay. In this particular case, they brought it all back, and there's some sort of, there's some sort of commercial correspondence about things getting shipped and things like that. So, yeah. What happened in this case, as far as I can tell here, is that McCormick brought the film back, and then it was developed and edited. By that time, Thompson had sort of disappeared, okay? There's something I'm actually following in the archives now about, there's like a plea from him. He's in Athens, Greece, and he wants McCormick to send him money, And McCormick says, buy him a third-class steamship ticket back to the U.S. and give him $10 and make sure he doesn't make off with the motion picture equipment. But then a couple of telegrams later, the report from the American legation is, he refused your offer and he's left for France with the motion picture equipment. He got money from somewhere. So, generally things would come back because, you could take film to London and have it developed there and maybe shown there. But, yeah, so there's a long time lag between the shooting, or fairly long time lag between the shooting of the film and its processing. And you just have to hope some censor doesn't played out. So it's a fairly perilous thing getting that stuff back in order to get it processed, you know? No satellites, no satellite transmission.
Well, I'd like to thank all of you for coming, and I'd like to thank Dr. David Mould and John Hartness for this terrific presentation tonight. And I'm sure that if you would like to come up and speak with Dr. Mould in person, he'd be happy to answer more questions. So again, thank you all so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you very much.